back to me, and I'm going to introduce our presenting sponsor. Of course, we could not do what we do without the support of great corporate partners. We're also a proud Florida Blue family for our team and our employees. But most importantly, I have known Dr. Penny Schaefer for many, many years and working in various community organizations. And I want to thank her because she wonderfully empowers her team. Martha De La Peña, Doug Bartel, Grace Eves, and others to be part of our community organization here. And so it's my pleasure to introduce, ladies and gentlemen, our presenting sponsor, a good friend to our chamber and a wonderful community leader, Dr. Penny Schaefer.
Thank you so much, Mark. And boy, I like the picture that's up on the screen because that's a pre-COVID picture. My hairstyle hasn't held up as well as that picture would indicate. You know, we're really, really pleased to be here, as always, as a part of this chamber's efforts. I hope you all noticed on Brian's customized background and the theme of come together that, in fact, the people that are in the crosswalk are appropriately distanced, and the people on the sidewalks are wearing masks. So congratulations, Brian, on reinforcing that message in what is a very difficult time right now for all of you and for all of our community. Pleased to see the numbers coming down. Pleased to know that we've been able to be responsive and help our community through this. And one of the things that has been really an eye-opener for all of us is the use of technology. You know, the technology's been around for a while, but the utilization, the uptake, is what has been impressive during COVID, and that is telehealth. The ability to actually receive clinical opinions, advice, and in fact have a complete encounter with a physician from the safety of your home or someplace else safe. No need to take the time to be transported. No need to expose yourself to a waiting room that may have other patients in it. We've advised our members to actually seek a virtual visit as their first clinical visit, because in many cases, a physician was able to rule out the symptoms and tell you that you didn't have COVID. In other cases, it was a chance to begin monitoring those symptoms and advise you appropriately of when to get the test and when to seek medical care. So we've seen a huge uptick. Some reports say as much as 4,000%. And so talking about technology and healthcare and talking about the technology that Florida Blue has made available to all of our members, not only for COVID, but for their routine visits, which were beginning to go by the wayside as people were afraid to come out. We're blessed that people are using technology. And it's appropriate that the next thing that we turn to is a panel on just that. The panel this afternoon is Phoenix Rising in Miami, the Entrepreneur's Blueprint for Defying the Odds. Our moderator is Melissa Medina Jimenez, president of Emerge Americas, which is the premier technology event of the Americas. You know, the mission of Emerge Americas is to serve as a catalyst for establishing Miami as the tech hub for the Americas in order to propel innovation and investment in South America or South Florida and Latin America. You know, with Melissa's leadership, Emerge Americas now brings together more than 16,000 entrepreneurs. Yes, I did not miss the decimal place or the comma. 16,000. These are investors, tech enthusiasts, and business executives from literally all over the world in a movement to connect the Americas through innovation and technology. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being with us, and please turn your attention and join me in welcoming Melissa and the panel. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Penny and Florida Blue, for supporting such a meaningful event. And I could not agree more that with you that the importance of telehealth right now, I think, is as pertinent as ever. So thank you again for all of your support and for an incredible introduction. I also want to take this time to thank my very good friend, Mark Trowbridge, and the entire Coral Gables Chamber of Commerce for the opportunity to be part of this. I am extremely proud to be part of the Coral Gables community. It's full of vibrancy and resiliency. My family and I have a very long, deep-rooted connection and love for the City Beautiful through organizations we are involved in, such as Sixtera Technologies, the Medina Family Foundation, and what I consider my sixth child, and the one that Penny just explained best, Emerge Americas. And I'm not kidding when I say sixth child. I have five children between the ages of 4 to 13 years old who are all in virtual school right now, here in my house. So I want to apologize.
Stop. Okay, let me call her now.
Wait, okay. I heard you. Sorry, I wasn't sure. I heard someone ask a question, I thought. Anyhow, I am in the middle of virtual schooling, five children, and this event as well. So I'm gonna apologize in advance if you hear any of them. It's very possible that one or two pop in the screen, but I guess this is also the digital norm nowadays, right? Kind of the convergence of real life and work life in a digital format. As Penny mentioned, Emerge Americas is a global tech platform with the effort to connect the Americas, spur investment in tech and entrepreneurship in South Florida, and ultimately help create a sustainable tech ecosystem of the Americas right here in South Florida. Over the last several months, we've obviously gone through several unexpected and unprecedented changes, as most other industries and organizations have, but we'll get to that later. I'm very excited about today's panel. As Penny mentioned, entitled Phoenix Rising in Miami, the Entrepreneurial Blueprint for Defying the Odds. I'm thrilled to be moderating such a fantastic lineup of panelists who are all surely going to learn so much from. I can't wait to hear all of their advice and their learnings throughout these tumultuous times. You know, in South Florida, we have gone through Hurricane Andrew and 9/11 and the 2008 recession, and now COVID, horrible global pandemic. South Florida has a rich history of birthing entrepreneurs that have risen from significant challenges. So I'm excited to now introduce our fabulous panelists. Steve Haas, you're there, is the executive director of Centerplate at the Miami Beach Convention Center, famed restaurateur, entrepreneur, and chairman of the board at the Greater Miami Convention and Visitors Bureau Convention Center. Locals and tourists alike have experienced his influence, which has permeated Miami culture and cuisine, as he is the creator and architect of something I love, which is Miami Spice, that he created after the devastating effects of 9/11 on the tourism industry. I'm also very proud to say that Emerge Americas, the conference, our annual conference, is hosted at the Miami Beach Convention Center every year since its inception in 2014. Stephen, thank you for being part of this panel. Our second panelist is Claudia Duran, who's the Managing Director of Endeavor Miami. She's a visionary entrepreneur with a wealth of experience in various financial, corporate, entrepreneurial, and nonprofit organizations. She's also multilingual and a multicultural global citizen. I'm very proud to serve on the board of Endeavor Miami under her direction, and I'm also very proud to work alongside Claudia on several initiatives. And last, but certainly not least, Eddie Arriola, founder, chairman, and CEO of Apollo Bank. He rose to the challenge of creating a community bank during a major recession and has since become one of the most influential figures in Miami. Since its creation, Apollo Bank has become one of the state's 25 largest financial institutions and made Florida's Trends list of one of the best companies to work for in Florida. The Arriola family and my family go way back, and always proud of you and your incredible achievements, Eddie. So thank you to the three panelists for being here today. So with that said, let's go ahead and start. We want to hear from you. We don't want to hear from me anymore. And just to kind of break the ice a little bit, if you did order from a restaurant in the Gables today, panelists, which one did you order from? Or which one are you going to order from if you haven't ordered from yet?
Coyo Taco?
Coyo Taco.
Was that even on the list? But yeah, that is what I ordered.
No, any. It could be any. Yeah. It's totally up to you. Steven, Claudia?
Gracianos.
Gracianos?
Well, unfortunately, Melissa, I'm actually at home in Bay Harbor, so I'm not going to be ordering a restaurant.
Fair enough.
But I will tell you that I grew up in Miami, and as when I started dating, all my restaurants were in Coral Gables. That's where I lived. My restaurant, a business started in Coral Gables for eating out.
Awesome. I'll share that I'm also at home, but I did order out, and it's waiting for me. And I ordered from Books and Books. I'm sort of obsessed with their quinoa salad there. But as you mentioned, lots of options in Coral Gables. So to all of you, and really, this is, I think, something important to talk about today. What is one positive outcome or blessing you have had during this COVID time? Here, I'll show you one of mine, which is just spending more time with this person, who, as much as I try to, you know, put her in her room or something, she's not having it. So it is what it is.
Hi.
Oh, she is so cute.
Thanks. So what have you all learned? Mine has been definitely more quality time with my family, I think, has been sort of a blessing in disguise that I don't think I realized before, but would love to hear from the three of you. Steven, if you want to go ahead and start.
Sure, I'll be happy to. You know, Melissa, you know, as we go through life, I always try to be as optimistic as I possibly can, no matter what we go through. And right now we're going through one of the strangest periods of our lifetime. Nobody could have ever foreseen what we're dealing with. But I always seek everything as an opportunity. And this is what I like to suggest to everybody, to look at it as an opportunity, because I know it feels so negative, but there are so many ways of changing and creating and being innovative at this time, as the whole world is becoming innovative and creative. And we're doing things that we never thought possible before, especially in technology. Technology is getting us through this. And, you know, I got to tell you, Melissa, I love when eMERGE is at the convention center, because it is such it's such promising, because I see the future when I see eMERGE conventions. You are the future, and it's great. You mentioned Miami Spice, so let me share a story. 9/11, I was running a company you might have heard of called China Grill Management. Mm-hmm. Delano Hotel, China Grill, Tuscan Steak, Red Square. Right after 9/11, I was in serious trouble, because I had 1,500 employees, and I'm trying to figure out how to keep them employed. You know, we went from doing almost 1,000 covers a day at China Grill to 30. And like, okay, how long is this going to last? And how, you know, what can we possibly do? Well, during this time, I actually opened 44 restaurants around the world for China Grill. And I was in New York during 9/11. So you can just imagine the depression. You can imagine everything. And I was opening up a Tuscan Steak in New York, 17,000 square foot, three-story restaurant. Well, New York was having Restaurant Week, which is very similar to Spice, but they do it for just 1 week. And here I am in New York. Here I am in a state of depression around people, and I could not get a reservation anywhere. Every restaurant in New York City was sold out. So I looked at my company, and I said, I have to bring this to Miami. So I immediately, after we opened Tuscan Steak in New York, came to Miami, and I called a meeting with the Greater Miami Convention and Visitors Bureau, my American Express, and the Miami Herald. To make a long story very short, in 4 hours, we created Miami Spice. And I personally went-
It's a staple now. Everybody knows about Miami Spice.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. It was an unbelievable experience for me, because as I walked into each restaurant, because I did it by myself with no help, I actually went into every restaurant to sign them up. And the very first year I signed up 54 restaurants. Only two restaurants actually said no. They weren't interested. They felt it was more like an early bird special type of thing. And it was just not their style, because I was only looking at high-end restaurants. Make a long story short on that, those two restaurants are on the program today, but they printed the first year. They eventually signed on. I am thrilled to say today there is about 250 restaurants on the program citywide, many Coral Gables restaurants. And it has been a joy to watch this become one of the most successful restaurant programs in America. Many cities have copied us. Many cities are doing what we do now. And I chose August and September because August and September 20 years ago were the two slowest months of the year for the restaurant industry. So I thought that would be a great way to get them going.
Absolutely.
And today, they are the fourth and fifth busiest months of the year.
Amazing.
Everybody who's on the program loves the program, but it's really great for the citizens of Dade County. And off, you know, I got to tell you, I know so many people that drive down from Palm Beach, from Fort Lauderdale, and from the Keys to take advantage of Miami.
No, I think it's definitely something that I know I look forward to and so many people talk about and can't wait till the Miami Spice season comes along. So can't thank you enough for sharing that. And I think like someone mentioned on the chat, I mean, incredible determination and insight to get that done here and now so many other
cities.
Well,
it was important for me to involve the city, you know, even though I had, you know, the four properties that I was very concerned about, I was more concerned about the city in general and what can I do to help everyone, not just my own company, but how can I embrace the entire city and take advantage of it?
Thanks. Thank you.
For those who don't know, Miami Spice is on right now. Normally it's just August and September, but we launched it June 1st. Just to stimulate the economy now, just to get people to come out.
And definitely much, much needed in these times. Thank you, Stephen.
My pleasure.
Eddie, can you tell us what has been sort of your, you know, what I would call blessing in disguise over the last several months, whether it's personal or professional, just something that, you know, has kind of been eye-opening for you?
Yeah, so for me, it was... So I thought I was actually going to be like isolated. As you know, we were planning on selling our company. So during that time, when I heard my son was coming back from college, I'm like, oh, great. We have an extended spring break. And so one of the things that I was not regretting, but not, you know, definitely not looking forward to was there's going to be this transition in my company where I wasn't going to be working closely with my team. So, you know, everything got flipped where I went from how am I going to spend my days to, you know, working 7 days a week, 14 hours a day, because banks were essential businesses. I've been in the office, you know, every single day. And our deal was canceled. So instead of spending the summer in Hawaii, we've been here every single day. And the great joy has been working a lot closer to our team and having them, you know, step up and share that, hey, I know you may not be happy that you sold the business, but we're really happy to work here and build our team. So to be able to go on, you know, sort of the next journey with them has just been a true joy of life. And I know that, you know, 20 years from now, it'll be one of the highlights of my career.
Absolutely. And I could say that I could see how your team would probably welcome having more time with you and you as an incredible leader that you are. So not surprising.
Thank you. Thank you.
But interesting to hear how that sort of pivoted and changed. Yeah. How about Claudia? How about for you? What has been sort of something surprising over the last few months, whether it's personal or professional? And
I would say that I discovered that you can be very productive by using all the virtual tools, just by being in one place. I remember I used to spend so much time in the car before, and that's time wasted from one location to another. So now it's very, very efficient, I think, the use of my time, which has actually liberated some of my free time for my passion, which is cooking. I love cooking. And so I've been able to spend more time with my husband, who also loves cooking. We took out all the cooking books we had just in the shelf, almost like all dusty. And we started just, you know, cooking and enjoying time together at home. And I think that was a blessing, you know, just finding something to do together, and also some time to call friends that I had not called in a long time. And I think that's a good thing, to connect with people that, you know, just to see how they are doing, if they're healthy, just being present for them, I think is very important for family and friends.
Yeah, and I think to your point, I think finding out that we could be more efficient with our time without having such fixed schedules has been really interesting for me as well, because I thought it would be a little more difficult and quite impossible, to be honest, but that has been eye-opening for me.
Yeah.
Lalia, now that, you know, we're talking, you know, you head Endeavor Miami and help entrepreneurs specifically in Miami, but really globally as well. As Endeavor, the parent organization, is a global network. You are at the front line with these entrepreneurs kind of going through this pandemic. What notable changes would you say you've seen Miami entrepreneurs and businesses make in the face of this unprecedented time?
Yes, I would say that when everything started back in March, Endeavor just started reaching out to all the entrepreneurs, not only in the portfolio that we manage, but also from the extended community, and just trying to understand what were their main challenges. Because I think it was such an weird time where people didn't know what was going to happen, and they had to pivot really fast their businesses, adapt, and think quick, right? What am I going to do to survive? So what we did is just talk to every single entrepreneur to understand how we could support them and connect them to the right people that can also support them. Because something that we've learned and that I always tell entrepreneurs is make yourselves vulnerable and know how to ask for help, because you don't have to do anything alone. And that's the beauty of having a network where you can just reach out to advisors and mentors and, you know, very strategic people that can help them in those difficult times. And for example, reaching out to banks that can also help them doing, you know, getting loans, or how to apply to the PPP. That was really, really important, getting them all to apply to the PPP or the disaster loan. So we were like hands-on supporting everyone on doing that transition. And I can tell like some of the examples where companies quickly adapted from a B2B to a B2C model, just because they had to quickly get into an e-commerce platform to sell their products. Or for example, other ones that had to really decrease personnel or furlough and restructure the company in a very efficient way and create a restart playbook, I would say, for the near future and how to really survive the crisis. So many things, many challenges. And one of the most important ones was culture. How do you keep culture in your organization? You know, you have all your employees at home and you're connecting with them through Zoom. Before you were with them, you were traveling, connecting with your key staff. So that has been also a learning, and how to support them to really communicate well with your staff, be creative with your, I don't know, create spaces that are fun so that you don't forget that you also can be, you have fun within, you know, the organization, doing a happy hour, or just bringing a very inspirational speaker to talk to your staff, and just, you know, little things that can help to maintain that culture, which is very one of the biggest challenges. Yeah,
absolutely. All great advice. And I think someone said in the chat, you know, mentors and friends and people that can support you through this are key. And I could not agree more. And I think your advice about trying to keep the culture is something that is extremely important and on point. I mean, with Emerge, we went, our staff completely digital as of March. And, you know, we have to, like you said, get creative on making sure that we're all keeping in touch and daily huddles. And even though they're through Zoom, that we're all not only keeping in touch for business purposes, of course, but also that we're a family and that we're there to support each other through these crazy times. But thanks, Claudia. Eddie, I want to ask you, because you know have the story and of building your bank and kind of coming up with this and founding it in the middle of the 2008 recession. So I just want to ask you, how did you come up with that? What sort of experiences allowed you to come up with this idea in the middle of this? And if you could just share a little bit more about that experience, because I think a lot of entrepreneurs and founders right now are probably thinking like, there's no way I could build something right now in the middle of what's happening. But I think you could give us hope that there is.
Yeah, right. So, I didn't go into it saying I want to start a bank in the middle of a recession. That's actually a really bad idea. The objective was, I want to have, on a personal level, I want to have a 10 plus year project that I can put myself into, that I can be excited about, that motivates me, that sort of brings out the best Eddie possible. So that's sort of how I started, and it happened to be during that 2008-2009 timeframe. I set out, like, you know, I want to build a great company, and great companies have to be great during good times and bad times. I wanted to have an impact on the community. I wanted to provide a safe, solid, long-term investment. So that's how I went into it. It just so happened that it was in 2008, 2009. And I'm like, I will always want to do these things. So I can take a step. I'm in the water. If I get out, I'm still going to want to do this a year from now, 2 years from now. So I just got to keep swimming to the other side. And I find myself, you know, the exact same learnings today. Like I said before, we were in the middle of this 10 plus year project, whose objective was to, you know, sell at a certain time, and we hit that time frame. And I'm literally sitting in, your business partner Felicia would see me like literally just hanging out, right? Waiting for close. And then this happened. And then it's like, I don't think, you know, Odysseus didn't set out to do, you know, two 10 plus year journeys, but that's the situation you find yourself in, and fate puts you there. And so it's during the hard times, I think it's great because. You build this scar tissue, and you build, you're forced to be resilient. And then it just makes you, better. And the journey just becomes, that much more interesting and rewarding. So I think if you have, if you believe in yourself and you have a strong network, and I think the hardest thing as an entrepreneur, CEO is, managing your own psychology and, the self-talk that you have. So it's not, you can have your own network and you can get great advice and you can read great books, but it's, what are you telling yourself? What do you choose to believe? And I think you have to accept that the world is probably working against you, but you have to believe that every morning you wake up that the world's transpiring to help you, that the world wants you to be successful, even if that's not true. And you just have to convince yourself and go and move forward, so.
Absolutely. And I think that's definitely a part of the end goal is your attitude. And like you said, waking up every morning and being grateful. And at the same time saying, I can make this happen. Because I think the flip side, if you keep telling yourself negative thoughts, negative energy, I think that brings about negative results. So completely agree. And again, super inspired by your story.
Yeah.
Steve, so I have a question for you. As we've talked about already with several entrepreneurs here today, Miami has a rich history of producing entrepreneurs in times of crisis. Why do you think that's the case? Is it something in the Miami DNA, or is this not geographic specific? I'm just interested to hear what you think, Steve, about that perspective. You're on mute, yeah.
Actually, it's a great question, and I think it has a lot to do with the diversity of our city. Our teams are very diverse in most of our businesses, so people are really getting different perspectives as they sit and talk to their groups and as they try to create. I think Miami, who has been so resilient for the last 100 years of its life, every decade we go an up and a down and an up and a down, we always come back stronger. And that's part of our history, and it's part of our DNA, who we are. We're very innovative, we're very creative, and the city as a whole tries to set the trend for the country. We don't follow the trends, we set them, we create them, and we make them happen. So I believe that Miami is a leader in the country, not a follower. And I think that with the right people and the right diversity, we are able to create things that the rest of the world follows. Everybody wants to see what's Miami doing.
Amen, amen. Agreed. Eddie or Claudia, any thoughts on that? Just like, Miami, South Florida, and why that's brought about such a...
Well, I think we have a lot of crisis, here from,
a lot.
Yeah, from the start, hurricanes in the 1930s, and we're built on a swamp, and so it's like the quote of, or I guess the saying, the Chinese, have two brushstrokes for crisis and opportunity. So it's if you have a lot of crisis, it creates a lot of opportunities, like the United States, but especially Miami is a very American city, although. some argue against that, but it's I think the most American city, right? Because
that's a whole discussion,
here,
I think.
Yeah, because people come here for opportunity. I mean, everyone that comes here, it's because, you know, they're fleeing another country, they're leaving New York, because like, I think it's gonna be better here than the place I was at. And so they're looking for opportunity. And if there's a lot of crisis, creates a lot of opportunities, and you're in this melting pot of people searching for opportunity, you know, magic's gonna happen.
I definitely agree that there's something to say about sort of a city built by immigrants, and they have this resiliency in them that I think many other cities may not have, just because of makes up the city. Claudia, yeah. Any thoughts?
I was about to say, you know, having that diversity and choosing Miami as their hometown just makes them, you know, continue to build it up. And I think the resilience is a very key. It's very important for, and I've seen it here in Miami, how people are resilient. And getting together as a community is another very important, you know, factor. You know, you don't have to do it alone. You build it up together. And that's how I've seen Miami go through all these different challenges. And I think that's what builds a strong community. And I feel that Miami is going to be at a great place, but I just see in the future is going to be at another, you know, amazing place, even better.
Thanks, Claudia. So a question I'll pose to all of you and whoever wants to kind of chime in. I mean, it's no secret that this pandemic has, you know, impacted so many businesses across the board. I think all of our businesses have been impacted in one way or another. Do you believe that much of this is going to be permanent, or do you believe there'll be, is this sort of just kind of a shift? For example, the digital workplace, do you think a lot of businesses will just say, okay, let's just stay digital because it's lowered our expenses? Or do you believe that this is just kind of a wave and we'll kind of get back to the way we used to do business in the near future? Curious to know your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think it's not going to go back to what it was. I think that there's going to be a mix, a hybrid. A lot of companies have, you know, really become very cost efficient by having virtual, a mix of virtual and in-person. Very important multinationals, like, you know, are fully virtual now. They're canceling a lot of the leases from the real estate they had. I've heard from consulting firms, you know, so I think it's not going to go back fully, but depends on the business, right? Because you also have business models that you need to be in person. Like, for example, restaurants, I hope that they go back to the normal, right? Because we all want them to be financially sustainable. I love going to restaurants, so I hope that we go back to the normal.
And
we're opening indoors on the 31st. So
that's great.
50% indoors, so which is great news for all the restaurants, I think.
Yeah. I can jump in just for a second. Melissa, it is great news. Many restaurants haven't been able to reopen because there is no exterior spaces for them to reopen. So this first opportunity, have they been able to survive to this point, hopefully, by opening their doors, even at the 50% occupancy capacity, they will actually have the opportunity of sustaining themselves and making and bringing back their employees.
Eddie, what do you think?
Yeah, so I'm of the opinion of that whatever the three of us say and the 100 and something people on this call and anyone else that you meet, whatever they predict about what's going to happen next, we're all wrong.
Yeah.
And, so I think we've been shot through this wormhole. We're going to come out the other side, and we don't know what is next. So I think it's we all have to sort of remind ourselves. I think it's a little premature if we're making sort of long term bets that there's still a lot left to happen. Even just in this year, is there going to be a vaccine? Is the economy going to get better or worse? What's the election going to look like? And, you know, you go back, you know, the flu of 19, what happened after the flu of 1919, after you had a war and all these people died? You had the roaring 20s. People would go into these little, it was illegal to go into a bar and drink. And people were like, no, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to get as close as I can to people and drink and party. And so you don't know what's going to happen with human nature. And so I don't know what's coming next. And so I was convinced of two things that were completely wrong. One was, early on that small banks weren't going to matter after this. People would be like, I want to keep my money in a safe and sound bank, and I only want to work digitally. And as you see through PPP, and I'm sure most of the people here had some level of participation. The big banks totally failed. I didn't predict that. I'm like, this is the end of small banks. And small banks became the heroes.
Big time. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And so I got that completely wrong. It was to our benefit. And then I started, what's the role of commercial, office space and that sort of thing. And so we've been open since day one. We have about a third of our employees working from home. And all of them want to come to work. And I'm watching a little chat group here. And people saying, I want to go back to work. I want to interact. And even though you hear Google and Facebook saying we're keeping all of our employees at home for extended period of time, Amazon's like, no, we're going the other way, and we're gonna, I forget the number of jobs, but it's tens of thousands of jobs that are gonna open up in New York City. Like, oh wait, I thought New York City was supposed to be dead. So I don't know what's gonna happen. I just know that we're all wrong. So
yeah. I think to your point, this year has just been full of surprises. And I think it really is hard to predict what's going to happen. And I think it's just such a fluid situation. And like I tell my kids who are kind of waiting to go back to school at some point, and I tell them right now, you know what? It's day by day right now.
Yeah.
We usually talk about the long term and the future. And I understand that. And you have to have a long term strategy. But in today's environment, it's sort of very difficult to plan that far ahead.
Yeah.
When you don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. So I think we're all completely on the same page. I wanted to ask each of you, what is the biggest lesson you've learned in your career? I know that's a loaded question, and you all have had incredible careers, and it doesn't necessarily have to be in a time of crisis, but if there was something that you could pass on to an entrepreneur, a lesson that you've learned, what would that be? Steve, we'll start with you.
Good question, Melissa. What lessons have I learned? I've learned that I don't always have the right answer or the wrong answer. I just don't have the answer. So talk to your staff. You never know who has that answer that will take you to the level you need to go. Remember to work with your teams. You're not the only one in the game. You're not the only one doing things. It's so much better to work as a team than as an individual.
Thanks, Steve. Eddie?
Yeah, so I love what Steve said, which is how he started was you don't know. And I think that's to be successful in life in business is to accept that you don't know and that you have to go and that's okay. And you have to go and find the answer. And usually it's through other people. I think it's really important to have a network and know who to trust. And you have to start building the skills to realize who is worth listening to and who is not worth listening to and what resonates with you and what is true to you and what might be the right answer for someone else may not be the right answer for you. And so, is to build a network and to accept that you don't have, you won't know everything and you don't know everything and that you have to create a path to figure out that the right answer.
Great advice. Claudia?
In my case, I come from a family of entrepreneurs. So I always grow up seeing my parents, they had their own individual businesses working so hard and I didn't understand why they were working so much. And now I'm like, oh, I understand that now. There's so, the passion when you're an entrepreneur, you just want to, build your business and grow it to the next level. And you work so hard because it's your baby, your project and your vision, right? So going through the journey of, coming from that family of entrepreneurs, then working with my family in the family business, was a turbocharged MBA for me because I had to really go in there and do a financial turnaround of the business. And that gave me, a higher level of empathy to connect with entrepreneurs now in the present moment. Because I feel their pain, I understand, and I can react quickly to find, people who can support them with their challenges and help them, find a right solution or at least get them there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, amazing advice. And I think there definitely has to be sort of this drive and passion when you're building any type of business, whether you're part of a team or you're building your own business, that's key to success. And if I can add one thing, I think from my career in business, I would say something that my father taught me at a very young age, and I really hold true to this day, is keep your word. You know, I think that in life and in growing a business, and you know, you make a lot of promises, and people don't forget that if you don't deliver on what you promise. So just kind of being careful with what you promise, and it's not to say that sometimes you're going to make mistakes, and if you are, just be honest about it. And I think that's something that kind of has always stuck with me in business and life in general. I think we're sort of at the time. I think we've been about 30 minutes. I'm not sure, Mark, if you want to let us know. I think we might have time for a couple of questions if anyone is interested that's watching and would like to ask a couple of questions. But Mark, if you want to let us know if how we're doing with time, because I think we're... Oh, the question is, what are your kids doing? Like, what are my kids doing right now? They're all five of them are in virtual school. They're all connected around my house as we speak, except my four-year-old that you saw kind of pop in. She had her virtual schooling in the morning.
And we may have noticed she was wearing an Elsa dress. Is that
yes.
true?
Yes. Absolutely.
I was a little bit nervous because I almost wore the same outfit today.
I love you, Mark.
You, I know, right, Steve? There's a question for you, Eddie, that came from one of our members. And let me see if I can find it here because it was up a little bit.
Oh, I see it. What is your take on the financial recovery? Time, okay. Struggles, changes?
So again, I go back to the thing is, you know, no one knows. Everybody's got things wrong. And so, you know, I think it's going to be, you know, town by town, sector by sector, country by country. I think long-term, you know, I shouldn't say long-term, I think Miami is going to recover a lot faster than and any other place. I, you know, we all probably know of people coming from, you know, especially New York and other parts of the country that want to be here. And there are people that are coming with talent and resources, and that's only going to, and that's, you know, when you go back to the crisis, that's what's really made Miami, especially, you know, call it like post, you know, post Hurricane Andrew, people coming here for opportunity. And that's always been kind of like a boost to the economy. So I think Miami will recover, you know, faster than a lot of places, but the rest, you know, again, you know, little restaurants and hotels, and I'm really concerned. I think, you know, as a chamber and especially local politicians, they need to be thinking about how do we jumpstart this thing? Because even if tomorrow we say, hey, COVID's over, we're rebooting, it's hard to say, I'm, you know, and Steve can tell you, I'm gonna start a new restaurant because I got to get capital and line up people. Yeah. And one of the things is like getting permits is a disaster. And I think that the Chamber of Commerce and local politicians need to say, we have to have a streamlined process to help everybody get up and running. Because if an entrepreneur is going to take the chance, we got to make it so easy for them. Mm-hmm. And that's a big concern because it doesn't, you don't go from 0 to 60 immediately. It takes a while.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think one thing that plays into that, which is simplifying the process, is more technology, right? Making this much easier and seamless. And I agree, we need to make that process easier for businesses to set up, especially in light of everything that has happened. And I also want to say I wholeheartedly agree with you, Eddie, that I think South Florida is in a very unique position compared to the rest of the US right now. And I agree that I think we will probably bounce back faster than other cities. And I think you see that in the real estate market right now. I mean, I know friends and personally that have listed homes or selling their homes and they don't last. And when you ask them who's buying them, it's people coming from other parts of the US that, God forbid, we're in this pandemic for a long time or another global pandemic hits us in the future. They want to be able to kind of enjoy where they live. And I think that that's where South Florida really comes in. So any other questions here on the chat, or Mark, any other questions that have been?
I think just more of an observation. First of all, thank you to you and the entire team at Emerge Americas, especially Ashley Abdullah, your rock star. She was so instrumental in getting us together and doing a lot of the prep work. And you know, this started as an email and a conversation several weeks ago, you and I checking in. So thank you. You know, Eddie, there's a lot of comments in the chat about what heroes the small banks have been. And I think you're 100% right in terms of recovery. We've been pushing the city, and the city's been really responsive to doing things, even in a very temporary pivot, you know, whether it's expediting permits or I don't want to call it looking the other way, but saying, you know, do what you need to do. When I interviewed Mr. Codina earlier in the week, I said, how did you get all of that outdoor dining done overnight in downtown Doral? And he said, we own both sides of the street. I said, well, I kind of like that answer. But you know what? That's what it's going to take in many cases to get folks to recover. So, and Steve, thanks for your comments too. We have a number of Coral Gables restaurants that participate in Miami Spice. A number of them, I hope, will kind of up the ante once we get open some of the dining rooms on Monday. And again, as Melissa said, that's the 31st. So get out there, support them. You know, today, the reason we did the gift cards for lunch is that we wanted you to order, but we also wanted to put $7,000 back into the restaurants and help them, especially, you know, with the challenges they've been through since COVID began. So Melissa, you want to remind everybody when eMERGE's proposed dates are for 2021?
Yes, April 26th and 27th of 2021. But remember, eMERGE is also much more than just our annual conference. We are a year-round organization, and our mission continues to empower entrepreneurs and create a thriving tech hub here in South Florida. And we do that through a plethora of different ways throughout the year. So yeah, please keep connected with our efforts here at eMERGE. And if we can be supportive of any of your efforts, you know, we're here to help. And just thank you again, Mark, and the Coral Gables Chamber of Commerce. This has been a really fun way to end my virtual.
Now it's back to school for you. Eddie, thanks so much for your leadership and constant support of our chamber and being part of the Gables community. And I certainly want to thank Claudia as well. Endeavor is a great part of the City Beautiful. And of course, eMERGE is here. And Steve, I think you know how I feel about you, honey.
Don't be shy, Mark. Don't be shy.
I know. Love your time, love your effort, and love your, you know, your enthusiasm. And I'm going to turn it back to our chairman to take us to the next phase. Thanks, everybody.